Polish-Ukrainian relations could be traced back to the medieval times, when in the 10th century, to be precise, Poland received its Christianity from Rome, so became a Roman Catholic country, and Old Rus from Constantinople and became an Orthodox country. And actually, already in the late 14th century, part of present-day Ukraine, East Galicia with its main city of Lviv, became part of the Polish kingdom, and that makes the history of this region association with Poland almost six centuries long. But the absolute majority of Ukrainian lands, or the lands of future Ukraine, if you wish, came under the Polish crown in 1569 as a result of the creation of Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, Rzeczpospolita, a huge state, the second largest in early modern Europe after the Moscovite, with 8 to 11 million people population. So this Commonwealth, Rzeczpospolita's domain, included the majority of territories of present-day Poland and Ukraine, as well as the entire territory of present-day Belarus and Lithuania and parts of present-day Western Russia. The southern eastern borderlands of the Commonwealth created a contact zone with the nomadic and Islamic world, the Crimean Khanate and the Ottoman Empire. Exactly this steep steppe era at the lower Dnieper River became a birthplace of Cossackdom, a particular social and military phenomena of the frontier, which quickly turned into a big problem in Polish-Ottoman relations. The Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth had a unique structure of power, with the same, a diet, as a sovereign and the representative of all nobility, which constituted up to 7-10% of entire population, and elected king. The country had unusually high percentage of noble stratum, and the largest Jewish population in the early modern world. How Rzeczpospolita dealt with the diversity of its lands and people? On the one hand, it remained rather tolerant towards different religions. On the other, it still welcomed conversion to Catholicism of the elites and the establishment of the Uniat, or Greek Catholic Church, subordinated to the Pope of Rome. The church union with Rome was proclaimed in Berestia, Brest, town in present-day Belarus, in 1596. Starting from early 17th century, the above-mentioned Cossacks strived to present themselves as defenders of endangered Orthodox faith to add important symbolic legitimacy to their social claims. The protection of Orthodoxy and the social guarantees for the Cossacks were the main slogans of the biggest Cossack uprising under the leadership of Bohdan Khmelnytsky. It started in 1648 and rapidly turned into a bloody war. Hetman Khmelnytsky, who constantly looked for international alliances, in 1654 finally succeeded in gaining support from Moscow, the only Orthodox state in the region. This agreement, broadly known as the Pereyaslav Treaty, opened an era of gradual transfer of Cossack Ukraine from Polish rule to Russian sovereignty. And from the long-term perspective, one could say that it was Russia who profited the most from the Khmelnytsky Wars. One of the possible solutions to Khmelnytsky claims, the creation of the Cossack autonomy, and even the transformation of the Commonwealth into a triangle structure, Polish-Lithuanian Kazakh Commonwealth, had never materialized. The last attempt was made in 1658 by Khmelnytsky's successor, Hetman Ivan Verkhovsky, who agreed on the establishment of the Ruthenian Duchy, Kiev, Bratslav and Chernigiv Palatinates, as the third part of Respublika Commonwealth. This project, known as the Union of Gadyach, was finally rejected by the same and remained a political fantasy. How could we summarize the balance of the Commonwealth experience for Ukraine? Igor Shevchenko, one of the leading Ukrainian-American historians, did it this way. Polish domination gave the Ukrainian elite a chance to participate in the currents of Western civilization in the 16th and the 17th centuries. The Ukrainian and Belarusian lands are the only Orthodox Slavic territories that widely experienced the Renaissance, and above all its aftermath, the Baroque and the Counter-Reformation. They are also the only Orthodox lands where intense contacts with Protestants took place, although little of that rubbed off from the upper classes onto peasants and rank and file Cossacks. For a period ranging between 1 century and 4, depending on the region, Ukrainians participated in the life of a non-centralized state in which individual freedom and the privileges of the upper class of society were respected. How could we summarize the balance of the Commonwealth experience for Poland, for Polish history? The same Igor Shevchenko mentioned the particular type of Eastern Polish accent, the formation of a class of Polish opponized magnates who owned enormous latifundia, private towns, huge armies in the territories of present-day Ukraine and Belarus, kept private armies and opposed any centralized executive, and by doing so, he, I'm quoting Shevchenko, prevented Poland changing into one of modern states. One could also say that in the early modern times, Poland became a window to the West for Ukraine, and Ukraine became a birthplace of Polish imperial fantasies. The particular Polish borderlands or Kresy mythology developed later, but it was related to the very notion of the borders of 1772, the first partition of the Polish Commonwealth. We'll talk a little bit later. In the late 18th century, three imperial powers, Austria, Prussia, and Russia, partitioned the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, the Nobilities Respublika. Over then, the Lithuanian Commonwealth was generally viewed as the worst example of political chaos and backwardness if compared to well-ordered, enlightened absolutism. The historiographical rehabilitation of Rzeczpospolita came much later, in the context of post-communist transformation of Eastern and Central Europe. Polish historians started to stress the achievements of the Commonwealth in parliamentarism, self-government, civil rights and religious tolerance, and to criticize its identification with modern Poland only. Some Belarusian and Ukrainian colleagues responded positively, claiming that, thanks to Rzeczpospolita, Belarus and Ukraine has a rich experience of democratic order and deep roots of parliamentarism. The international attention to non-nationalistic forms of political organization and historical alternatives to ethnic nationalism made Rzeczpospolita an attractive and provocative comparison to the European Union. Timothy Snyder, in his influential book, explicitly made such a claim. Warsaw and Vilnius, as you might say today, pooled their sovereignty at Lublin to establish the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. The early modern Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth was far greater in territory, ambitions, and European significance than the two small nation-states that today bear its names. Its citizens believed that they had created the best political order in the world. Their republic embodied practices of democracy, civil rights, religious toleration, and constitutional rule now regarded as European par excellence. The appeal of the early modern Commonwealth had more to do with the political ideal than with the specific institutions, which is why its attraction outlived its polity by more than a century. Something similar can be said about the postmodern European Union, its reputation and civilization. Does such comparison really make sense? And are all of the positive visions of the Commonwealth completely free of hidden Polish imperial fantasies and connotations? Could Polish experiences in Ukraine be compared to the French experiences in Algeria or British in Ireland? That's a set of questions I'd like to ask you to think about. The end of the 18th and the beginning of the 19th centuries could be described as a time of open possibilities, of coexistence and competition of estate and history-based versus ethnic and language-based concepts of nationality. The Polish case is of particular interest in this respect because here the process of modern nation formation started from the political phase, from the definition of the nation as a sovereign community of citizens, but not of a people with the same ethnicity. This community was limited to the noble stratum, and language and religion did not make Polish peasant closer to the Szlachtich, the nobleman. The very idea of winning over peasants for the nation's case came to the political avant-garde later. In the late 18th century, Russian Empire was an estate dynastic monarchy with little attention paid to the ethnic composition of the population of its ex-Polish provinces and an attitude towards members of the Schlachterstratum as first and foremost landlords, and only after that the Poles. And what about Ukrainian national movement? The Ukrainian national movement in the 19th century adopted the ethnographic principle and claimed a goal of cultural autonomy for all territories with predominantly Ukrainian peasant population. In cultural claims, at least at first glance, seemed to be rather harmless for a number of imperial officials in both Habsburg and Romanov empires who were much more preoccupied with stronger Polish national movement. At the same time, at least under particular circumstances, both empires sought to use the Ukrainian card against one another. That is why, in the 19th century, the Polish political discourse tended to see any Ukrainian identity that would not integrate into the Polish nation as a Russian or Habsburg intrigue. And the Russian discourse gradually became used to explain the Ukrainian movement as a Polish intrigue. In the second half of the 19th century, the leaders of Ukrainian movement in Russia eagerly expressed their anti-Polish sentiments, simultaneously stressing political inevitability of joint development of Ukraine and Russia. Following the point of Mykola Kostomarov made in 1861, they portrayed Ukrainian people as profoundly democratic and Poles as profoundly aristocratic. The issue of the elites was of special importance here. One of the founders of Ukrainian historiography, professor at Kiev University and a Polish nobleman by birth, Volodymyr Antonovich, insisted that the noble Poles in Ukraine should either return to their nationality, abandoned by their ancestors, or to resettle to the Polish lands inhabited by Polish people. So you see how this logic of ethnographic borders works here. A very different view on the elites issue was presented by another Pole by birth who made a conscious choice in favor of Ukrainian identity, Vyacheslav Lipinski. Unlike Antonovich, Lipinski was proud of his noble origin and praised Schlachter for its statehood value. Still, he was no less convinced in the fundamental importance of separating Ukraine from Poland, but in a such a way that will not mean drowning in the Russian Sea. That was a quote. The main challenge for modern Polish national project once again was a bit different because of the fact that the area of the Polish Szlachta settlement significantly outsized the era of the predominantly Polish peasants. The acceptance of the ethnic concept of the nation would in Polish case automatically mean the dramatic reduction of motherland. In other words, Polish patriots had to choose between two radically different concepts of the Polish nation, the old historical conception of a multi-ethnic political nation of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and the new, narrowly ethnic peasantist conception. Throughout the 19th century, the majority of Polish writers and political thinkers believed in the possibility of preserving the borders of 1772 in future Poland. They also insisted on cultural differences between the Ukrainians, usually called Ruthenians, Rushini, and the Russians. At the same time, they would barely question the cultural inferiority of Ukrainian peasants and their natural longing to the Polish culture. For instance, the leader of the nationalistic political camp, Roman Dmowski, expressed his deep conviction that, quote, Ruthenian culture could only become the foundation for a movement with an exclusively cultural character. If National Democrats, and that was the name used by Dmowski and his followers, believed in political, if not cultural, assimilation of Ruthenians, their main opponents, Polish socialists headed by Józef Piłsudski, developed the utopia of federation of Eastern European nationalities under Polish leadership and united against Russia. One of the most prominent supporters of socialist federative plans, Leon Wasilewski, in 1911, called for the acceptance of the national character of Ukrainians and support of their independence aspirations against Russia. At the same time, he rightly predicted the Ukrainian-Polish conflict over Lviv-Lvov because, quote, such a conflict is inevitable if two nationalities, the one socially and politically privileged and the other humiliated, populate certain area together. Wasilewski appealed to the democrats of both nations to do everything to minimize the scale of future violence. And his plea proved to be more than relevant in less than 10 years in the modern times. And that will be the topic of our next lecture.